Hello and welcome to this evening's Dartmouth Symphony Orchestra Bartók Watch Party. This evening's concert features Bella Bartók's Concerto for Orchestra, which was performed a year ago by the DSO live in Spalding Auditorium. What a different time that was. And hearing this concert tonight again gives us an opportunity to reflect on this particular moment in time and consider our history, which at one time welcomed Bella Bartók and so many of the world's most acclaimed artists to seek refuge here in the United States. With their arrival came a vibrancy and diversity and internationalism in our culture, society, and the arts. And we've taken for granted that aspect of our culture and our nation. We expect that kind of internationalism and diversity as part of our American landscape. Yet today, the fluidity and kind of internationalism we've come to know is threatened by our circumstances. The pandemic is isolating, limiting opportunities for travel and visits from artists from around the globe, and rising nationalism in this country and around the globe has further limited our perspectives. Tonight's conversation is the first of many we hope to have that remind us of the value of thinking globally and what's left behind when we close ourselves off as a country, as individuals, and how we can better stay connected. So I'm excited to start these conversations with our guests tonight. Ted Levin is known here at Dartmouth as an esteemed member of the music faculty. Additionally, Ted has been at the center of the founding of Silk Road Ensemble with Yo-Yo Ma. He's done his own research and producing of global traditions in music and serves as an advisor and producer to the Aga Khan Music Initiative. And I'm very happy to be able to say that the next of these conversations and events will take place on November 10th, when the HOP will become the premier site to welcome the latest installment of music from Central Asia developed by Aga Khan Initiative. And we hope that tonight's events entice you to join us and continue the conversation then. Also with us tonight is Filippo Ciabatti, music director of the Dartmouth Symphony Orchestra, also faculty member and acting director of the Glee Club and Handel Society. Filippo gives us an opportunity to hear his perspectives on internationalism as an immigrant himself. And he also gets to give us some insight as an artist educator, bringing this musical life to a diverse global university community. And so we thank Mr. Bartók for giving this wonderful music to us and that we'll hear a little bit later, and for reminding us that deeply rooted musical traditions can be lasting and vibrant. So Ted, I'm gonna ask you to get us started. Bella Bartók came to the US in the mid 20th century after a lifetime of exploring the music of his ancestral roots. Because of that and with that, he brought so much to the United States with his emigration. What do we know of what Bella Bartók contributed to our collective culture?
Thanks, Mary Lou. You know, for me, Bartók has always been an inspirational figure because he was at once a leading figure of the European modernist avant-garde and also a serious ethnomusicologist who sought out the oldest and, in his view, the purest forms of folk music that he believed held the key to a kind of spiritual power and authenticity. And he transformed this material into his own unique compositional voice. Plenty of people before Bartók had collected folk songs, but Bartók went about it in a way that was systematic and scholarly, laying the groundwork for what would become my discipline, the academic discipline of ethnomusicology. He started collecting folk songs when he was 24 years old in 1905. And he continued this work until almost the year that he emigrated, 1940. At the time of Bartók's early collecting expeditions, Hungary was much larger than its present size, which was cut back after the downfall of the Austro-Hungarian Empire and the Treaty of Trianon in 1920. But when he was collecting, he had access not only to ethnic Hungarians, but to a wide range of ethnic groups in Eastern Europe, which included Slovaks and Slovenes and Ukrainians and Ruthenians and Romanians. So he was a cosmopolitan. And for him, it was very important to have this openness, this freedom to move around in Europe. That's what stimulated his art. It was this contact. I want to share, I have some photos here that I'd like to share of these early collecting expeditions. And I think they helped to illustrate just what a kind of weird juxtaposition it was of this erudite guy who became, you know, one of the leading figures of European modernism, getting his inspiration from illiterate Hungarian peasants and, you know, peasants of other ethnicity. So if we could have the first slide, please. This is Bartók recording in 1908 with his Edison wax cylinder machine, which at that point was pretty new technology. He's recording Slovak musicians here. You see him standing there next to the singer. These machines could only record at that time, I think, 2 minutes at a time. And he used this so that he could transcribe. He was known as a fantastic transcriber. He could get the most minute detail of these very complicated rhythms and scales, embellishments. The next slide. Many years later, these collecting trips continued for his whole career, as I mentioned. Many years later, he went to Turkey. And here he is in Turkey, sitting in his jacket and tie with these shepherds. His interest in Turkey was because he believed, and in fact, it's been established, that there's an ancient connection between the Hungarians and the Turks who came from Central Asia. And he wanted to establish that connection in music. It was based on pentatonic scales and other kind of structural features that he found. But in fact, this has been shown by scholars to be the case. And he was really the first one to point this out. So this, here he is in 1936. If you could show the next slide, please. Here he is again in Turkey. He's sitting in this ox cart with the Turkish composer Ahmet Adnan Saygun, who was a leading composer of Turkey. Also, like Bartók, a modernist, but interested in folk traditions. I knew Saygun. I met him in Central Asia in the 1980s. And he told me a lot about his time with Bartók. It was fascinating. And, you know, this kind of work that Bartók started is still going on. And I've been part of that. If you could show the next slide. Here I am 80 years after Bartók in 1987 in a yurt in Tuva in Siberia. I'm no longer using an Edison wax cylinder recorder, but a pulse code modulator, PCM, which was the first digital technology, recording technology. And it was probably not much lighter than Bartók's wax cylinder machine. We lugged that thing around Tuva into yurts, and here we're doing a recording session of throat singers. But this idea of recording music and using it as a source of inspiration for some kind of new creativity is something that is very much going on now. And Bartók was really one of the progenitors of that. As Mary Lou mentioned, in 1940, he came to the United States, escaping from Hungary, or not escaping, but leaving. Hungary had sided with the Axis powers. And he went to Saranac Lake, New York, ultimately. He was invited first by Harvard to give some lectures, and then later by Columbia. But he ended up in Saranac Lake, which is about 3 hours west of Hanover. And there he received a commission from Serge Koussevitzky, the conductor of the Boston Symphony Orchestra, to write a concerto for the orchestra. He got paid $1,000 for writing that piece, which wouldn't buy you a lot of music these days. But he went to Saranac Lake, and I want to show you the place where he wrote the concerto for orchestra. He sat in that cottage, and he wrote it. He finished it in 2 months, and he finished it just about 77 years ago to the day, 77 years and 1 week ago, to be exact, from today, sitting in that cottage. And then the final slide, in 1944 and 45, he returned to Saranac Lake and lived in that cottage where he wrote the two last works of his life, Viola Concerto and the Third Piano Concerto. So this idea that, you know, this great modernist European composer came to the States and found here what he was looking for, the tranquility, the peace, and really the openness to create. And, you know, I think this is just more evidence that music and art need open borders in order for ideas to flow back and forth. And this is maybe a good time to segue to Filippo and for me to ask him a question and bring him in. Filippo, first of all, I want to congratulate you on preparing this extraordinarily difficult and challenging score for the Dartmouth Symphony Orchestra. Kudos to you and to all the musicians who did such a fabulous job of performing it. But maybe you could share with us some of the challenges you faced in working with the musicians and bringing music that in a way is so foreign to our ears. And, you know, this is part of what Bartók was doing, of bringing into this language of modernism the kind of rhythms, you know, polyrhythms that he found in these, particularly among Turks, three against two, for example, that the Turks call aksak, or the modal scales. You know, Bartók spoke about the tyranny of major and minor. He explored all these kind of weird scales, dissonant intervals that we find sometimes, you know, very unpleasant for the ear. So tell us about what it was like to work with the musicians and to prepare this score.
Well, thank you very much, Ted, for the question. And yes, and I also want to say before I get into the more specific aspect of Bartók, that I really echo Ted and Mary Lou's word about how enriching it is to make music in an international open environment like Dartmouth, and how much better the music making, how beneficial is the music making to have a group, also the Dartmouth Symphony, of people that really come from all over, come from any kind of tradition, me included. So I am very thankful, and I recognize profoundly the value of this, right? Regarding the Bartók Concerto for Orchestra, the first thing I want to say, like that I wanted to reflect upon, is the title, right? Because the idea of a concerto for orchestra is in itself a contradiction, might seem in itself a contradiction within the title. The word concerto comes from the Italian language and from the word concertare, that really means to arrange, to get together, to agree, right? And then during the course of history of music, the concerto became more and more something that had to do with some sort of virtuosic quality of a soloist, you know, a show off of a soloist. In fact, we call a piano concerto as a concerto for piano and orchestra, violin concerto, etc., right, for violin and orchestra. The concerto for orchestra, so, seems kind of a contradiction, right? How can be something that values soloist then be thought holistically for orchestra? And it was a strike of genius, I would say, on the side of Bartók, because he really invented something that then was, Lutos Laski, for example, later wrote a concerto for orchestra, very famous. And I think he really is able to convey these two aspects, right? The virtuosic aspect of instruments, right? So there is a lot of virtuosic aspect in this music that is extremely difficult for any musicians. In fact, it was written for the Boston Symphony that had some of the best soloists in the world, and still has, of course. So there is this aspect of real complexity, of technical complexity. And at the same time, there is something profoundly cohesive and primitive about this piece. And what would you were saying, Ted, about the rhythm, right? This ancestral primitive rhythm that he takes from his own tradition and permeates in this music, right? So for me, with the students, before, the first thing we had to do is to overcome this hurdle, right? The technical aspect, the technical difficulty, and really try to learn it and understand it in its mechanism. Once that was mastered, I think that the basic aspect of this piece, the, you know, a little bit like in Stravinsky, you know, the basic aspect, this ancestral primitive rhythm, are very relatable to young people and young musicians. So once we were able to overcome that first step, I think afterward for the young musicians was quite natural to kind of relate with this kind of music, that it's so deeply rooted in certain rhythms that all of our young people and all of us, but especially young people, listen to in many genres of music, right? So this is what I think that this tradition brings to this piece and what we could kind of understand from the work that we've been doing. And actually, in relation to that, I was going to ask a follow-up question to Mary Lou. Mary Lou, you talked about internationalism in music. You want to talk about what the hop is doing and to continue to follow up on this very virtuous tradition?
Yeah. You know, we're having this conversation because, in fact, the Hopkins Center has had a longstanding commitment to international artists and presenting international work to make sure that we're contributing to the global dialogue. And given the fact that we are a very diverse community here, it's very important for all of us to not only hear and feel represented in the artistic work that we see in the Hopkins Center, but to be awakened and to hear things anew or see things anew when we see others' cultures. So building a community that is open, that is curious, that is interested in overcoming whatever obstacles there are to creativity is part of what the Hopkins Center's job is, on top of and almost like the icing on the cake for the academic work that's being done in the classrooms. Creativity and personal creativity is the future of for all of us, and that's what we're trying to foster at the Hopkins Center. And when we do our job well, it's those are the times when we offer the stage to artists that bring new visions, new ideas, lift us up, and give us an opportunity to hope and to see things in new ways. So just as a very, this time is going very quickly for all of us, but I'd love to know what you see as the humanistic values, both of you, just briefly. What are the humanistic values that you see coming from preparing and performing and being part of creating a work like this? Ted, you want to start?
Yeah, well, you know, speaking particularly about Bartók and his music, which I found personally always inspirational, you know, the humanity of that music to me lies in the deep understanding and respect that it shows for such an astonishingly diverse range of world music that extends from the simplest melody sung by, you know, in Bartók's case, an illiterate Hungarian peasant, to the most sophisticated music of the European modernist avant-garde. He created a kind of musical parody between cosmopolitans and peasants. Quite a few of Bartók's avant-garde contemporaries and successors didn't seem to care much whether regular people listened to their music. They were writing for fellow sophisticates or intellectuals or bohemians or hipsters. But Bartók wanted his music to connect to a broad range of performers and listeners. He wrote music for beginning pianists and violinists, as well as works like the Concerto for Orchestra that have become extremely popular with audiences around the world. And in all of this music, Bartók educates us. He expands our sonic imagination and shares with us the grandeur and the wonder of music that he discovered during his lifetime of of musical exploration.
So a great equalizer in many ways. Filippo, quickly, one last reflection on the humanistic value of this work.
Yes, I actually wanted to, I think Ted responded very eloquently on Bartók. What I wanted to reflect a moment upon is the importance of the popular aspect of music, right? And how we should never lose that, right? I'm thinking about my own cultural identity, the Italian identity. And I think, for example, for us, our opera, what opera has played in our lives and how important it has been to the culture of everybody. You know, I was, you know, my great grandfather, there was a plumber, you know, personally speaking, he was a baritone by passion, and he loved music and he loved opera. My grandmother, there wasn't a particularly literate person. She had a subscription to the opera theater all her life. And she's seen some of the greatest musicians of the world. I have all of her libretti still. So I think that we should continue to promote accessibility in music. Mm. And remember that this music is included the music of Bartók that did, as Ted says, this incredible work to make sure to be able to do this parody, as he said, right? To melt traditions. But we should remember that music is for everybody. And
in concertate, right?
Exactly.
For everyone, per tutti. So with that, I think we're just about out of time. And I'm so excited to invite our audience to join us for the concert. You can click on the YouTube link that's right below your screen. And I just want to shout out to the students who are gathered together to within social distance rules to watch this party. And watch the concert. And I know some of you will be in the chat. So audience members, get ready with your questions. I know our students will be really anxious to hear from you. So thank you, Ted. Thank you, Filippo.
Thank you.
Ciao.
Ciao. Thank you.